cleanse my guilt and pride. Blood of Christ the crucified, from your hands, your feet, your side, Jesus, I trust in you.
Look in Acts 17 and verse 11. Some of y'all probably know this by heart, but it's so true. Acts 17 and verse 11. And this is talking about Paul and Silas when they were speaking to the Bereans. It says, now these were more noble than those in Thessalonica, in that they received the word with all readiness of mind. You know, it's awesome that you can go to non-Christians and they can receive the word with readiness of mind. It's the Christians that have a hard time receiving the word of God. In many cases, it's because of the traditions that have been given to them that they can't receive what you have to say. The thing that made it more noble was two things. One, that they received the word with all readiness of mind. Can you read the word and accept everything it says? Think about it. Do you have problems accepting some things? Do you have problems saying some things? Can you say anything the Bible says? The Lord showed me this one time. If you feel nervous saying or repeating what the Bible says, then it's probably because some tradition in you is making war against the word. So he says they're noble because they received the word with readiness of mind, examining the scriptures daily, whether these things were so. Examining the scriptures daily. That's part two there, to a noble Christian. Examining the scriptures daily. You know, I would say the overwhelming majority of Christianity wouldn't think about doing that. And the reason they wouldn't think about doing that is because they respect men. They respect their leadership. They have high regard for men. That's a dangerous thing, you know. I mean, every religious group believes it's right. And if they were all right, think about it. It's not possible if they're all right. So there's a lot of error out there. And yet, notice that all those religious groups, the people that are in them, believe that they are right. Have you ever believed that you were totally right and been totally wrong? I have. I was raised in Catholicism. I thought I was right. Then I went on to the next religion, and I thought I was right. And then somewhere down the road, the Lord opened my eyes, and I began to see, you really can think you're totally right and be totally wrong. One of the problems is, I believe, is a respect for man. These were more noble than the Thessalonians because they examined the scriptures daily whether these things were so. You know, we need to be spending more time in the scriptures than going to church or listening to men. You know, people stay in bondage to false religious theology all their life because they don't examine the scriptures to see if these things are so. You know, we call this, I felt the Lord tell me to call this Bible study the Unleavened Bread Bible Study. And the reason is, let me turn to Exodus chapter 12. While you turn there, I'm going to read this verse to you in 1 Corinthians chapter 5. And it says, purge out the old leaven that you may be a new lump, even as you are unleavened. For our Passover also has been sacrificed, even Christ. Wherefore, let us keep the feast, not with the old leaven, neither with the leaven of malice and wickedness, but with the unleavened bread of sincerity and truth. You see, you can't keep the feast of the unleavened bread with Christ unless it's sincerity and truth. Truth is the only thing that is unleavened bread. The Bible says the things that happened unto them, speaking about the Jews, was for our admonition, upon whom the ends of the age have come. And they were for types. Okay? Look in the Exodus chapter 12, and here's the story of the Passover. Now, as soon as you read it, you begin to recognize who the Passover lamb is. Everybody recognizes that as Jesus, right? Verse 5, He says, your lamb shall be without blemish, a male, a year old. You know why it had to be a year old? The Lord told me one time why it had to be a year old. Because a year represents death, burial, and resurrection. Think about the year. Every year, the seasons, they go through death, burial, and resurrection. And here's a lamb that had to be a year old in order to be sacrificed. And you shall take it from the sheep or from the goats, and you shall keep it until the 14th day of the same month, and the whole assembly of the congregation of Israel shall kill it at evening. And they shall take of the blood and put it upon the two side posts, and on the lintel, and upon the houses wherein they shall eat it. And that's a symbol, that's a sign that in order for the death angel to pass over, you know what the death angel represents?
Curse.
The curse, that's right. Today, the death angel represents the curse. And the curse is involved in a lot of different things. Really, the best way I ever had to explain it was that the curse is all things detrimental to man because he's disobeyed God's word. And Deuteronomy 28 is a list of the curse. And then God put a little stipulation in there. He said, and if it's not written here, God will put that on you too. So, I mean, he is literally covering everything with the curse. And this death angel represents the curse. The curse of sin and of death, you see? Curse of death. The blood had to be upon the lintels and upon the doorposts because for a Christian to be walking out from under the curse, he has to be walking in and out under the blood of Jesus. You know, the Bible says in 1 John 1:7, if we walk in the light as he is in the light, we have fellowship one with another. And the blood of Jesus cleanses us of all unrighteousness. To be walking under the blood is to be walking in the light. You say, well, sometimes I fail to walk in the light. Well, there's another stipulation about the blood in that if we repent and confess our sins, God is faithful and just to forgive us and to cleanse us of all unrighteousness. So the thing is, we need to be confessed up with the Lord, and we need to walk in the knowledge of the light that we do have. The Bible says when we walk in the light, you know, the Lord only holds you accountable for the light that you do have, you know. To him that knoweth to do good, doeth it not. To him it is sin. It's according to knowledge, okay? We continue to grow in our knowledge, and we become more and more responsible as we grow in our knowledge. But it's really neat that the Lord doesn't hold against us a lot of things that we don't know. This is a pretty thick book, and there's a lot of things in it that we don't know. Well, God says, in the absence of law, there's no transgression. Meaning, if he hadn't told you that it's wrong, and your conscience doesn't tell you that it's wrong, then you don't have to worry about it. A lot of people are condemned, and they feel like they're condemned because they're just not good enough. Well, that's not good enough. If you're missing God, you already know where you're missing God, because your conscience is condemning you, or the Lord has spoken to you out of his word about it. You already know that, you see. He's not going to be condemning you for something you don't know. Okay? That's the really good deal that we have in the new covenant, because now we can walk under the blood and we can stay there. Ignorance keeps us from obtaining all of God's benefits, but he does not impute to you sin when there's ignorance. The Bible says that in Romans chapter 3 and Romans chapter 4. So the first thing they had to have was the, and a lot of these symbols in here are the same, actually. To walk, remember, how does the blood apply? If we walk in the light. See, everybody says, well, I'm under the blood. Well, the blood's applied. The blood washes away your sins when? When you make a decision to walk in the light. Boy, wouldn't it be nice if all Christians understood that. 1 John 1:7. If we walk in the light, as he is in the light, we have fellowship one with another. See, some people don't get past that part, right? Because if you walk in the light, we have to have fellowship one with another. And the blood of Jesus cleanses us from all unrighteousness. That doesn't sound like the teaching on the blood I've heard in a lot of churches. Do you? Doesn't you? No. See, Christianity, it should be discipleship. and not just accepting the Lord Jesus Christ. Let's see, let me read the rest of that verse. It says, verse 8, and they shall eat the flesh in that night, roast with fire, and unleavened bread. With bitter herbs shall they eat. Eat not of it raw, nor boil it all with water, but roast with fire. Its head, with its legs, and with the inwards thereof. See, this lamb is Jesus Christ. Paul tells us that in the New Testament. And he tells us that we're supposed to eat this lamb, all of this lamb. We're supposed to eat its head, the legs, and the inwards. We're not supposed to leave any of this lamb, until morning. Why? Now, you know, a lot of us in here are from different religious backgrounds, and we've noticed most of us here have been through at least one religion before we found out that it wasn't necessarily a religion that we were supposed to be following, but the Lord's, you know. And we noticed that our religion accepted certain parts of the Word of God, and the next religion that we went to accepted other parts of the Word of God. And I went through about three religions before I realized that the Lord wanted me free to accept all of the Word of God. Well, that's exactly what this is talking about, is to eat all of the lamb. You know, religion seems to, not only is it sectarian in nature in dividing the body of Christ, they seem to think they have more wisdom than the Word of God because they can pick and choose what parts they like and what parts they don't like. Well, we don't have any choice if we're going to come out from under the curse. The only way to get out from under the death angel was to eat all of the lamb. The head, you know what that is? That's the mind of Christ. Mind of the Lamb, the mind of Christ. The Bible says we have the mind of Christ. If you accept the leadership of the Holy Spirit, you have the mind of Christ. Okay. If you don't, and you walk after the flesh, you must die, the Bible says. Okay. The head with the legs. Anybody got a good idea what the legs might symbolize? The walk. Yes, the walk. Amen. Well, you know, the Bible says, anybody that says he abides in Christ, let him walk as he walked. This is how we can prove that we abide in Christ, is to walk as he walked. Well, what do you think that means? And I've got the idea that Jesus said, if you don't take up your cross and follow me, you can't be my disciple. Do you suppose that walk could be to go to our cross? I mean, that would be part of it, right? And then pass the cross to resurrection life. See, because the Bible does teach us to go on. We're entering into his resurrection life, his overcoming resurrection life. Do you suppose that's what he's talking about? By the wall, not just holiness, but we're going to our cross. He said, we couldn't be his disciple unless we would take up our cross and follow him. And that's, of course, we were talking about this the other day. Sue and I were talking about this the other day. The cross is not what a lot of religious groups say the cross is. The cross is to die to self. It's not to live under the curse. You see, some people think, my cross is I'm living under this curse, and that's my cross. No, if that was so, then Jesus came in the form of Antichrist because he was delivering everybody from their cross. I mean, he delivered everybody from the curse. Was he anti-God? Was he against God in doing that? No. The same people he was delivering from the curse, he was telling that they needed to take up their cross and follow him. So obviously it wasn't meaning to go back under the curse. The cross is to put to death the old man. The old self, the fleshly man, you see. Some people have made their cross sickness. That doesn't please God, because then Jesus died for nothing, you see, for them. The Bible says, by his stripes you were healed. The Father sent Jesus not only to take upon himself our sins, but to take the punishment on his body that we would take had he not done that. However, we self-righteously say, I'm going to endure this punishment on my body. Then in our case, Jesus took those stripes for nothing. That doesn't make sense. What do you think the Father feels like when he sent his Son to suffer the penalty of our sins? And we consider that we're going to keep on suffering the penalty of our sins, and we're going to ignore that sacrifice. I wouldn't imagine that the Father would appreciate that. I wouldn't appreciate it if I sent my Son to do that. And he doesn't either, because Jesus came to show us the will of the Father. Remember, they said, show us the Father. Have you been with me so long? If you've seen me, you've seen the Father. In other words, you saw how Jesus was. You saw his heart towards God's people. His heart towards God's people was a heart of deliverance, a heart of preservation, a heart to meet their needs, a heart to heal their body, you know, all those things. That was the heart of God. That was the heart of the Father. It was revealed to us through Jesus Christ. So that, I believe, is the next part here, and the inwards thereof. Mine says the inwards. I don't know what yours says. But that's the head, the legs, the inwards of the lamb. They had to eat the whole lamb. Verse 10. And you shall let nothing of it remain until the morning. But that which remaineth of it until the morning, you shall burn with fire. In other words, if you miss your chance to eat the lamb before morning, you're never going to have another chance. And it's interesting in Exodus chapter 16, the same, almost a quote of that, Moses said about the manna. Exodus 16 and 19. And Moses said unto them, let no man leave of it until the morning. He was talking about the manna that they had gathered, you see. Now, don't leave it until morning. You know what? Daily, those Bereans searched the scriptures, and they were more noble than the Thessalonians. Daily, they searched the scriptures. And you know what? God is saying, what we leave undone today, we'll never get it again. See, tomorrow God has its own manna. If you don't get the manna that God's got for you today, you're never going to see it again. You know when they tried to save it up for the next day, what happened to it? It bred worms. Bred worms. Meaning, hey, if you don't get what you're supposed to get today, you're just not going to get it. Right? That's the same with the lamb. You know, in Exodus 16 and verse 4, the Lord said unto Moses, behold, I will rain bread from heaven for you, and the people shall go out and gather a day's portion every day, that I may prove them whether they will walk in my law or not. A day's portion every day, that I may prove them whether they will walk in my law or not. See, the most important thing for us is not going to church. The most important thing for us is to gather the manna every day, eat our manna every day. And let me show you a little key. Chapter 16 and verse 31. Every once in a while, God puts a little key in there so you can understand things. He tells you who the manna is here. That the house of Israel called the name thereof manna. But you probably have a footnote that says Hebrew, man. Anybody got that footnote? Man. You know, Jesus said he was the man. He was the man. And he said, except you eat my body and drink my blood, you have no life in you. That's not eating everything else. That's not eating what all the religions have to feed, you know. All the second, third, fourth, fifth, sixth hand stuff that they pass on to you. It's all traditions, you know. We need to go back to the Word. It's the only thing that has the power to really feed us and give us life. So, except you eat my body. And he was the Word made flesh. If you don't eat my body, you have no life in you. He was the Word made flesh. So his body was the Word of God. There's a parable there. See, his body is the Word of God. So God wants to try us to see if we're going to walk in his law or not. Are we going to get our manna every day? Are we going to eat all of the lamb? Are we going to go just as far as our religion will permit us to go? Hey, we don't believe that. We don't accept that. We don't want to believe that. That's those Pentecostal people, and that's those Baptists, and that's those, you know, who cares? Yeah. See, Babylon has been divided up over the tongue, just like it was back at Babel, you know. This group over here eats this part, and this group over here eats this part, and this group over here eats this part. All pieces of the lamb. But the only way you're going to get all the lamb is to stop being sectarian and stop being guided by these really idolatrous religious organizations, and begin to read the Word and believe what you read, and accept everything, accept all of it. All of it was put there for us. To eat all the lamb is to partake and believe, just like those Bereans. They accepted the Word with all readiness of mind. They weren't hung up on all their religious traditions and all their voodoo theology, you know. Let nothing of it remain until the morning. Back in Exodus chapter 12. Let nothing of it remain until the morning, but that which remaineth of it until the morning shall burn with fire. And thus shall you eat it, with your loins girded, with your shoes on your feet, and with your staff in your hand, and you shall eat it in haste. It is the Lord's Passover. Well, that sounds like they were ready to go, right? And they had their staff, their shoes. You know, if you're not partaking of the word with an eye to get up and leave Egypt, then you're not keeping the Passover. This was part of the Passover. When you eat the lamb, you got to be ready to walk out of Egypt. And that's what they were. They were ready to walk out of Egypt. You know, how does that apply to our life? When you eat the lamb, you got to be ready to walk out. You can separate yourself from the world. Egypt symbolizes the world, right? We've got to be ready to separate ourselves. You know, because the more you become a hearer of the word and not a doer, the more your heart gets hardened. You just keep hearing it, you keep getting hardened. Pretty soon your conscience is so cold that when you read it, it does nothing for you. And you're not going to do anything with it. And you just sit there and warm a church pew or something, you know? So, we need to be doers of the word, not just hearers, you know, deluding ourselves. Let me read on down just a little bit. I'm getting to the verse that I think the Lord gave me concerning the name of our Bible study here. He says, "For I will go through the land of Egypt," verse 12, "in that night, and will smite all the firstborn in the land of Egypt, both man and beast. Against all the gods of Egypt will I execute judgments. I am the Lord." You ever seen God execute judgments against the gods of Egypt? He's doing it, isn't he? He's doing it right now, isn't he? There's curses on all kinds of things that people love. Things that people put before God, there are curses on. "And the blood shall be to you for a token upon the houses where you are, and when I see the blood, I will pass over you, and there shall no plague be upon you to destroy you when I smite the land of Egypt." No plague. No plague. You think they had the better covenant, or we had the better covenant? The Bible says we have a better covenant based on better promises. "And they were delivered of all plagues as long as they walked under the blood." Isn't that interesting? All plague. Now, a plague means an infliction, a blow. If you'll notice, all the plagues that were listed in the book of Exodus here, the murrain of the cattle, the boils, the hail, the locusts, the darkness, the frogs, the lice, the flies, the water turned into blood, and the thick darkness, that's not what we would call a plague, is it? That's what God's calling a plague. In fact, in chapter 11, in verse 1, he says, "One more plague I'm going to bring upon Pharaoh and upon Egypt, and afterwards he's going to let you go." Well, that was the Passover. You wouldn't call that a plague, would you? We would call a plague a pestilence, wouldn't we? Okay. Well, he's talking about all these blows are plagues. That's what he's calling plagues. So, you know, when he says we're delivered of all these plagues, he's talking about all these kinds of curses, all different kinds of curses. Even the Passover was a plague to God. The murrain of the cattle, the flies and the lice and the bugs. So all these were plagues. And he said, if you walked under the blood and you ate all the lamb, that you'd be delivered of all these plagues. I've seen that. I don't know if you've seen it, but I've seen it. There are different groups in Christianity that believe different parts of the word. And the part they believe, they receive the benefit of. And the part they don't believe, they're not eating the lamb, and they're under the curse. And the part they don't believe, they live under that curse. A lot of different groups would benefit from other groups if they weren't so sectarian and dogmatic and respectful of man. Because if men tell them, no, we don't believe that anymore, it doesn't matter that they won't give them any verses. If men will say that and they respect the men, then they decide not to believe that anymore. That's idolatry. None of this has passed away. Thank God. Because people are all receiving benefits. All over the world, people are receiving benefits of eating the lamb. You know? Verse 14. "And this day shall be unto you for a memorial, and you shall keep it a feast to the Lord. Throughout your generations, you shall keep it a feast by an ordinance forever. 7 days shall you eat unleavened bread. Even the first day you shall put away leaven out of your houses. For whosoever eateth leavened bread from the first day until the seventh day, that soul shall be cut off from Israel. There's a lot of reasons for this. We put away leaven out of our houses. Out of our house. What's your house? Yeah, he's talking about this house, isn't he? He's not talking about this building. Right? He's talking about this house. To them, it was a building. But to us, we're walking in our house. You see, this is our house. And so he says, put away the leaven out of your houses. If you don't, between 1 and 7 days, have that leaven out of your houses, then you're going to be cut off. And the seventh day was called the rest. So we know we're supposed to eat unleavened bread until we enter into the rest. Okay? Now, to some people, that's the kingdom of God, right? Heaven. Well, that's one parable, and that's a pretty good one, I think. You know, we're supposed to eat unleavened bread until we enter the kingdom. And the seventh day was the day of rest. We're coming to the day of rest. We're coming to our day of rest. Everybody's coming to their day of rest, right? What do you think leaven could be? I've seen at least three areas where I thought that we could be leavened. Number one, I want you to look at Matthew chapter 16 and verse 6. And Jesus said unto them, take heed, beware of the leaven of the Pharisees and the Sadducees. We still have that leaven today, okay? And they reasoned among themselves, saying, we took no bread. And Jesus, perceiving it, said, O ye of little faith, why reason ye among yourselves? Because we have no bread. Do you not yet perceive, neither remember, the 5 loaves of the 5,000, and how many baskets you took up? That was 12 baskets. Neither the 7 loaves of the 4,000, and how many baskets you took up? And that was 7. How is it that you do not perceive that I speak not unto you concerning bread, but beware of the leaven of the Pharisees and the Sadducees? Then understood they that he bade them not beware of the leaven of bread, but of the teaching of the Pharisees and the Sadducees. Now Jesus was given a teaching here about leaven. The leaven of the Pharisees, the leaven of the law, by the way, is salvation by works. Most of Christianity believes that they can only be saved by their own works. You say, well, no, not really. Well, yeah, it is true. Because if you understand how big salvation was for the spirit, the soul, and the body of man. That's how big salvation was. Most groups only accept that your spirit can be saved, and the rest of it, God just waits till you get to heaven to give you, right? Not true. Not true. That wasn't Jesus' method. Jesus was concerned about the whole man. He healed the whole man. He delivered the whole man. He brought salvation to the whole man. He brought salvation in circumstances, like when they were in the boat, and the boat was filling with water. The disciples said, save us, Lord. Well, that's the same word, salvation, save. When they were demon-possessed, the Bible says they were, and Jesus cast the demon out, the Bible says they were made whole. That's the same word, saved, the exact same word, sozo. Of course, soul salvation, same thing. It was the same word. See, salvation in the New Testament is translated several different ways. But if you go back to the original Greek, it's used for salvation of your spirit, salvation of your soul, salvation of your body, salvation of your circumstances. It covers all that. In other words, everything that the curse has affected, salvation covers. Some groups, their salvation is so small. But our salvation is so big, you know, it's awesome. Well, the salvation teaching of the Pharisees was it was salvation by works. God needs your help, in other words. But look at the parable. It's not even a parable. This actually happened. He said, 5 loaves and 5,000. With 5 loaves, they fed 5,000 and took 12 baskets up. Then there were 7 loaves. It only fed 4,000. And there was only 7 baskets taken up. In other words, the more they contributed towards the work of God, the smaller the miracle, and the less left over. That's what he's teaching about the leaven of the Pharisees. The more you put in of yourself, God doesn't want your works, he wants your faith, right? He wants us to believe him. You know, what could the guys do out in the boat when the water was still in the boat? I guess they could have bailed a lot quicker, right? And they would have probably sunk anyway, right? They could have just bailed a lot faster, got more buckets, whatever, you know, whatever they were using to bail the boat out. But all they needed was Jesus. When they turned to him by faith, he said, "Peace, be still." And it was all over. He didn't want their works. He said, "Oh, you have little faith." He rebuked them for their unbelief. He didn't want their works, he wanted their faith. The teaching of the Pharisees is a salvation by works. And most of the church is the same way. It's salvation by works. But did you notice, what did Jesus ever charge anybody for his salvation? It was free. Didn't matter what form it was in, it was free. What did they need to contribute except faith to receive God's salvation through Jesus Christ? Nothing but their faith. That was it. The only condition Jesus ever put upon it was their faith. He rebuked them, "Oh, ye of little faith, why did you doubt? All things whatsoever you ask in prayer, believing, you shall receive." What was the condition? Your help? No, just believing, you know. "As you have believed, so shall it be unto you." You know, most churches, the condition that they put in the place of faith is the will of God. Is it the will of God? We can't know the will of, well, they haven't read the Bible. If they don't know the will of God, they haven't read the Bible. But because Jesus never used that as a condition. That was never a condition for anybody to partake of God's salvation, for anybody to get healed, for anybody to get delivered, for anybody to get saved, for anybody to be delivered from the storms of life, you know? It was only one condition. He mentioned it over and over and over. "Be it unto you according to you, but as you have believed, so shall it be unto you." So we like to put all these other conditions in there because that's leaven of the Pharisees. That's what that is. They're trying to put all these conditions, trying to give you reasons why you can't believe the word of God and why you can't partake freely of God's salvation. Freely of God's salvation. And so, you know, it's awesome. I mean, I've been in some churches recently and showed them, listen, when did Jesus ever say to someone, "Well, it's just not the will of God"? And they can't find one verse, and yet that's their condition for not receiving from God. So, leaven can be teaching. You know, the Apostle Paul, I mean, it obviously is teaching, it's teaching the Pharisees and the Sadducees. But the Apostle Paul told us in 1 Corinthians chapter 4 and verse 6, he said, "Learn not to go beyond the things that are written." See, when you go beyond the things that are written, that's leaven. The unleavened bread is the unleavened bread of what? Sincerity and truth. So, the unleavened bread is only truth, you see. Sincerity and truth. 1 Corinthians chapter 5, I believe it's 6 and 7, somewhere along here. Also, look at Luke chapter 12, here's 11 too. It's not just the teaching, it can be your attitude. All right, here's an example, Luke chapter 12 and verse 1. You know, not only do we need the truth, we need the attitude of Jesus. We need the emphasis of Jesus. Remember the other night we were talking about something that I said was really insignificant, we shouldn't argue over such a thing. Have you ever seen people argue over the oneness and the Trinity in the Bible? Yeah, never saw anybody argue over such things in the Bible. Look at verse 1. "In the meantime, when the many thousands of the multitudes were gathered together, insomuch that they trod one upon another, he began to say unto his disciples, first of all, beware of the leaven of the Pharisees, which is hypocrisy. So your attitude can be leaven. Hypocrisy. Hypocrisy, what does that remind you of? Right, what is it? It's somebody that wants to appear righteous, but they're not going to be obedient, right? They want to appear to be something that they're not. 1 Corinthians 4 and 6, it says, "Now these things, brethren, have I in a figure transferred to myself and Apollos for your sakes, that in us you might learn not to go beyond the things which are written, that no one of you should be puffed up for the one against the other. learn not to go beyond the things that are written. You know, think about it. Learning not to go beyond the things that are written. Have you ever studied a Sunday school manual? Where did that come from? First of all, it came from the guy that wrote it, right? But where did he get it from? Somebody taught it to him, right? Somebody taught it to him. And somebody taught it to him. And somebody taught it to him. It's not first-hand material. See, it's second, third, it might be 50, 60, 100. Because if it's a denomination, it could have started way back there. And you're still getting it passed on to you, you see. The thing is, what the Lord wants us to do is partake of the unleavened bread. That's to go right back to the Word. I don't think we ought to be studying anything but the Word. Why fill yourself up with a lot of things that you've got to go and find out if they're right or wrong? And then, if they are wrong, according to what you see in the Scriptures, then you have to overcome your religious pride and say, I was wrong, and you have to repent. Some people aren't willing to do that. See, it's a lot easier to go to the Bible and get the truth firsthand than it is to get it second, third, fourth, fifth, 100,000, so on and so forth. Because, listen, there's no new lies today. I don't know if you've ever looked at that, but I've gone back and read some of the early church fathers' writings. And stuff. There's no new lies. This stuff's been going on for 2,000 years. The leaven of the Pharisees started there, and it's still going on and on and on. There's no new lies. There's no new false doctrines. You can find them back in history, all the way back. It's amazing. It's awesome, you know.
My thirsting soul, purest water, make me whole. Let your streams of mercy flow, oh Jesus, I trust in you. Though the mountains fall into the sea, though the rivers rise, I still believe. For your mercy stands and your word is true, oh Jesus, trust in you.